going to begin an expository series based on the most powerful book in the Bible showing God's sovereignty, I think, the book of Revelation. Refresh our knowledge of just what the coming years will bring according to the book of Revelation. So that's my little introduction to this. And the reason for this being, I want this church, if anyone would come into this church, I want you to have an answer for what people might ask. Because I think there's going to be more and more questions coming up. You know, if they would just say, well, you go to church, what do you believe about this? I'm hearing this on television, I'm seeing this in the papers. We need to refresh our knowledge of just what these coming years are going to bring so that we'll have that answer. Because we should be seeing more and more things begin to happen. The days go on and the years go on. Michael, you really impressed me because just the short time that you've been here, you know, to go from what is all this that I'm hearing to now you're really thirsty. You want to hear more and more, you know, and it's like, I want to get more tapes on this and all. I'm going to guard everybody against getting more tapes. The fact that it is, the book of Revelation, there's a lot of prophecy, a lot of things are beginning to unfold right now. Christians are really on top of this. It also becomes a real commercial market. And everybody's going to want to write a book. You know, everybody's been involved with the thing in Washington. Everybody makes $1 million, has got anything to say or had any connection with anything that's going on with Washington. So the same thing with this. Every pastor is going to be trying to do it. The internet's going to be flooded with people's ideas. You know, I'm just coming down to just simplicity, the simplicity of it. Everything we need to know about the book of Revelation or about the end times or about what's going to come is right here. We don't have to go any further. It's right here. And God has told us in the out of the Bible that he's given us, that he will give us the education, he will teach us by his Holy Spirit. We don't have to go much further than that. It's all right to read something, but don't take it seriously, you know. Pray about it and see, there might be parts in there, little pieces in there that might spur you on and say, and it gets you back to the Bible again. You start to study these things. But in the simplicity of a study, that's what I want to enter into this, that we take it precept by precept. I want to make it a short teaching so that afterwards we can even discuss it, you know, and all of us join in. Phyllis has got a lot of knowledge, and I know that a lot of us do, and we'll be able to compare notes. If we want, stay as long as we'd like, and to be able to discuss the little bit that we go, step by step, so we have a thorough knowledge and understanding and belief of what we believe in, as the Holy Spirit would teach us. Now, having said that, I think that we really need to go back to Daniel to get a running start in this teaching. Every time I want to get to Revelation, I have to go back to Daniel. And where is he? I used to call Daniel the belly button of the Bible. It seems that everything's connected to Daniel somehow or other. So you're going to see a little bit of that right now. So if you have your Bibles, you don't have your Bibles, and I didn't print them out because I want you to carry Bibles, guys. I would like you to turn to Daniel chapter 9. I'm going to read quite a bit here because this is kind of setting up this little beginning of what I want to establish in our heads before we get started here. Let's pray. Father, by your Holy Spirit, will you teach us and show us, Lord, the truth here. Guide us now down a path that's not complicated but simple, that we can understand every step that we take, that we might become teachers, as Paul says we should be teachers by now. Not that we stand up on a pulpit and teach, but that we have an answer when people ask us. These are important times, God. I know they are. And that you're calling us to, even as a small group, that we would have the answers for those that might ask. And then you will send them to us individually. We ask this in Jesus' name. And I'm starting off with verse 1, right in the beginning of chapter 9. It says, in the first year of Darius, son of Exerzes, a Mede by descent, it was a Mede, who was made ruler over the Babylonian kingdom in the first year of his reign. Then Daniel goes on to talk. Now, you understand what we're talking about here. This is after the bondage, when God basically turned Israel over to the Babylonians and Nebuchadnezzar. And Nebuchadnezzar went in there and just trampled them all. And there are stories about that he went around and he was actually looking for nice-looking, strong, muscular men to stand around who were intelligent, to stand around in his temple and be able to talk to people. And Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you hear about those guys, they were all, so evidently, they're all pretty good-looking, big, husky-looking guys that could stand around and talk intelligently, you know, and obviously be able to talk in their languages as well, probably. But Daniel was one of these guys. So Nebuchadnezzar spared them and brought them in and put them in a special position in his kingdom there. And this is now later on down the road. And you've heard about the fire. When Daniel was gone somewhere out praying, I guess, and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, these are the names that Nebuchadnezzar gave him, they got in trouble and ended up in this pit. And as they looked down, as they could see that there was four in there. And he said, no, there's supposed to be three in there. There's four. And we know that that was God, and Jesus was in there with them. And so all these different stories that you hear from this period of time. But at this time here, we're coming around to a time when God's going to release the Israelites again. They'll be able to go back. But we're talking here, Daniel has been asked to interpret the dreams. Nebuchadnezzar and the different kings there, they were going to have all their soothsayers killed and everything. This always goes on. If they can't predict or interpret dreams and all this, then kill them. You know, so we saw that with Joseph too. But here Daniel, he says, I, Daniel, understood from the scriptures, according to the word of the Lord given to Jeremiah the prophet, that the desolation of Jerusalem would last 70 years. And they were in bondage for 70 years. So I turned to the Lord God and pleaded with him in prayer and petition, in fasting and in sackcloth and ashes. I prayed to the Lord my God and confessed, O Lord, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of love with all who love him and obey his commands, we have sinned and done wrong. We have been wicked and have rebelled. We have turned away from your commands and laws. We have not listened to your servants, the prophets, who spoke in your name to our kings, our prince, and our fathers, and to all the people of the land. Lord, you are righteous, but this day we are covered with shame. The men of Judah and people of Jerusalem and all Israel, both near and far, and all the countries where you have scattered us because of our unfaithfulness to you. Oh Lord, we and our kings, our princes, and our fathers are covered with shame because we have sinned against you. The Lord our God is merciful and forgiving, even though we have rebelled against him. We have not obeyed the Lord our God or kept the laws he gave us through his servants, the prophets. Now I'm just pausing there. This is a condition that we are in today. Israel was in this condition, and we are in this condition today. So I'm just kind of, as I read this, I'm just comparing this to even our country, our world, as we're in this situation. I've said as I've taught, well, this is the way it is. The Bible says it's going to be this way. We can see in the Bible what it's going to be like, and it has to wind down. We have to be this way. We're being handed over so that we can be raised up. But Daniel knew this too. But what does he do? He's still on his face before the Lord is praying and telling God all of these things, that he understands these things. He knows where his people have been unfaithful, and all of them have been unfaithful, and they deserve the worst. In 11 here, all Israel has transgressed your law and turned away, refusing to obey. Therefore, the curses and sworn judgments written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, have been poured out on us because we have sinned against you. He's just laying it all out. God, I understand all of this. You have fulfilled the words spoken against us and against our rulers by bringing upon us great disaster. Under the whole heaven, nothing has ever been done like what has been done to Jerusalem. He's not complaining, but he's saying, I understand. 13, just as it is written in the law of Moses, all this disaster has come upon us, yet we have not sought the favor of the Lord our God by turning from our sins and forgiving or giving attention to your truth. The Lord did not hesitate to bring the disaster upon us, for the Lord our God is righteous in everything he does, yet we have not obeyed him. Now, O Lord our God, who brought your people out of Egypt with a mighty hand and who made for yourself a name that endures to this day, we have sinned. We have done wrong. O Lord, in keeping with all your righteous acts, turn away your anger and your wrath from Jerusalem, your city, your holy hill. Our sins and the iniquities of our fathers have made Jerusalem and your people an object of scorn to all those around us. Now, our God, hear the prayers and petitions of your servant. For your sake, O Lord, look with favor upon your desolate sanctuary. Give ear, O God, and hear. Open your eyes and see the desolation of the city that bears your name. We do not make requests of you because we are righteous, but because of your great mercy. O Lord, listen. Lord, forgive. O Lord, hear and act for your sake. O my God, do not delay because your city and your people bear your name. While I was speaking and praying, confessing my sins and the sins of my people Israel, and making my request to the Lord my God for his holy hill, while I was still in prayer, Gabriel, the man I had seen in the earlier vision, came to me in swift flight about the time of the evening sacrifice. He instructed me and said to me, Daniel, I have now come to give you insight and understanding. As soon as you began to pray, an answer was given. Now, I just want to give you this. God knows our prayers before we even pray. So when we have, that's why he says that we don't have to keep going over and over and over and over on things. He knows what we're praying. As soon as we pray, an answer has begun. And you can believe that. That's why even Phyllis has done this. If you don't say, oh God, please do this, say, God, thank you for doing this. Because if we ask, it will be done. You know, he says he will do that, two or more in his name. So we have to thank him. It may not come in the time we would like it to come in, but the work has begun to accomplish that prayer. And we see here that this is, Gabriel said it. As Gabriel says that, I'm going to believe it here. He said, as he instructed him, as soon as he began to pray, an answer was given for you, our highly esteemed. Therefore, consider the message and understand the vision. Now, this is why this is important. Because, you see, this is one of the most important times of the Bible is when Israel was put into bondage. It's got to be. This was something that God did for 70 years, handed his people over to this evil nation to get them straightened out. And what we saw from Daniel here, they didn't get straightened out too well. They were still doing things they shouldn't do. But Daniel asked for forgiveness, which God would do. Now he says, now listen to this vision. So we need to see this vision right now. 70 sevens are decreed for your people and your holy city. For why? To finish transgression, number one. To put an end to sin, number two. Put an end to sin. To atone for wickedness, that means clean it all up. To bring an everlasting righteousness, that's forever and ever, whenever it says everlasting. To seal up vision and prophecy. What does that mean? Except that there will be no more vision and prophecy. So that has to be the end. And to anoint the Most High has to be anointing Jesus as he returns. 25, know and understand this. From the issuing of the decree to restore and build, rebuild Jerusalem. See, they're sitting over, now picture this, they're sitting over there in Babylonia, and he's getting this vision, and he's praying for that time when they can rebuild Jerusalem. That's what he was asking for, to rebuild the temple and rebuild Jerusalem. Until the anointed one, the ruler comes, there will be seven sevens and 62 sevens. It will be rebuilt with streets and a trench, but in times of trouble. After the 62 sevens, the anointed one will be cut off and will have nothing. The people of the ruler who will come will destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end will come like a flood. War will continue until the end. The desolations have been decreed. He will confirm a covenant with many for 1 7. In the middle of the seven, pay attention to that, he will put an end to sacrifice and offering, and on a wing of the temple he will set up an abomination that causes desolation until the end that is decreed is poured out on him. Chapter 9, this thing that Daniel wrote down was powerful. I mean, Daniel got a lot of powerful things, but this was like something. If I was Daniel, I'd be saying, where's my calculator? I got to figure this thing out. What is this vision that I just got? Because obviously, it tells the whole story. So that's why I wanted to start off with this, because this is basically what Revelation is into. There are 14 main parts to this prophecy. Without a clear understanding of them, many other prophecies cannot be fully understood. So let's look at the first of the 14 parts, the meaning of the 70 weeks. Now, you probably know these things. It may be redundant, but that's what I'm saying. We need to refresh our minds and go over this. The phrase 70 weeks literally means 70 sevens. And the reason is Hebrew for week. They don't say week. What the Hebrew says is seven. They say Shabbat. So when they take a week off, they take a Shabbat. They talk in sevens. And this is what the language was. So actually, they were talking in sevens. We are looking at 70 sevens of years. Because Daniel's prayer, to which this vision was an answer, did not concern days, but years. So we're looking at years. The last 7 years, see, we saw over here, see, I said 70th week. We're talking about 70 weeks of 7 years. Right? The last half of 70th week is 3.5. Then the first half is also 3.5 years, making 1 7, which is verse 27 over here that we just read. He will confirm a covenant with many for 1 7. So there's going to be a covenant with many for 1 7. So now you know when we say the last 7 years, when we're talking about the tribulation period. There's a lot of different things that we should be coming into now. According to all prophecy and according to everything that the Bible has been saying, we should be right on the doorstep of this last 7 years. This last seven. If the last seven is a period of 7 years, then the other sevens are also 7 years each. The whole period being therefore 70 times 7. That's why I have 70 times 7 on that. 490 years altogether. Now, see, remember when Jesus, he was asked, when will the end time, when will the end come? And he says, only my Father knows this. I don't know this. Nobody knows this. Only my Father who's in heaven knows this. I just had to think when I was getting ready this morning that this was before Jesus was sitting at the right hand of the Father. And so after he goes to be at the, with the Father, he gives a revelation to John, and so that we'll be prepared for this when it's coming. This is where the book of Revelation is so important. And for generations, they could not understand a word of it. And I think even the Catholic Church made it so that it was illegal to even read. A lot of churches made it so it's illegal to even read the book of Revelation. There was a whole thing on prophecy. It became an evil thing to teach prophecy for a long time because they were scared to death of this. You know, they didn't even want to get into it, you know. But it's been in my lifetime that all of a sudden it's been revealed. It's basically in my lifetime, probably close to my lifetime, that the book of Revelation has been revealed so that people can understand it now. All of a sudden, and it says in end times, that there will be more education, there will be more understanding, people will understand things and learn things more in the end times, an increase of knowledge, it says. So this maybe is what it is, that now it's time to read it. And now it's time to know the book of Revelation. So the book of Revelation is preparing us for this period, this last 7 years here and beyond. Isn't it interesting that I was thinking also that when Peter asked Jesus, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to seven times? And Jesus just says in Matthew 18:22, I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Maybe he was thinking about this. 70 times 7, which means 7 times 7 or 70 times. It's the same thing as we have here. I was just wondering if God was thinking, I forgave the Jews with this number at one time, you know, at the same time. But as we would forgive, that this is a popular number. The second part that we need to look at is would be the division of the 70 weeks or seven sevens. They're divided into three main periods. The first division, seven sevens, or 49 years for the rebuilding of Jerusalem. So there's going to be 49 years for that Daniel was told that Jerusalem would be rebuilt. Okay, there's the first part. The second division was 62 sevens, which would be 434 years for the completion of the city at the end of the 49 years to the time Messiah is cut off. And we saw that in verses 20, 25 and 26. So it was all divided up from that time to getting the temple built, Jerusalem was going to be rebuilt, and then 434 years after that until Jesus, the Messiah, is cut off or crucified. The third division, the last, is the 7 years that we're talking about right now. That I'm just saying, the last 7 years. Now, everybody understanding this? Now, what happened between Jesus getting crucified and the last 7 years? See, this is the point I like to bring out. There's a big chasm here. In verse 24, it says, 70 sevens are decreed for your people and your holy city. What does your mean except Daniel's people and his holy city? I just want to look at that again because this is a big controversy. Verse 24, 70 sevens are decreed for your people and your holy city to finish transgressions, to put an end. But see, he says, for your people and your holy city. God is speaking through Gabriel to Daniel, specifically saying what this last 7 years is all about. It's to clean everything up for your city and your people. This is why this church, or at least I believe, the tribulation period is for the Jews, because that's who the Israelites were. Daniel's people and his native city was Jerusalem. So this is basically focused on Jerusalem and the Israelites. It does not concern the church in any sense when you try to look at it in Scripture. In fact, the church was not begun until the 69th week. So that's what I'm saying. At the end of those 434, you know, when the crucifixion comes, that's that it stops. Now, that's why we talk about the 70th week. Everybody says the 70th week, Daniel's 70th week. And you'll hear this a lot, people discussing this. Daniel's 70th week. That's seven years that has been postponed. It stopped at 69, and it's been pushed back, and we don't know when that 70th week is going to start. And this all in here, all of this period is to build the church. God is building his church. This is the church age. And when he has completed the church age, when he's got us all ready and the full number is there, and he lifts this church up and sets it before his throne, this is what I fully believe with all my heart. Then the 70th week comes in. What's the 70th week for? Your people and your city, just like he told Daniel. So that this last 7 years is for the Jews, it's for Jerusalem. It's to restore that and bring that to where God would have it be. Now, will people be there? Will Gentiles be there? Sure. Because they're not going to be ready to go. It's that simple. The present church age rightfully comes in between the 69th and 70th week, during which time Israel is rejected of God and scattered among nations. There is a postponement of the fulfillment of the 70th week immediately following the end of the 69th week due to Israel's rejection and her house being left desolate until God restores it again in the days of the coming Christ. In Psalms 102:16, it says, "For the Lord will rebuild Zion and appear in his glory." So we see that Psalms even reflecting on that period when Jesus is going to return to Jerusalem. The great tribulation will be during the last 3.5 years. The first 3.5 years will be a lesser tribulation due to the fact that Antichrist will be only rising to power during that period.